The northern Philippines experiences heavy rains due to Typhoon Henry.
A Philippine House panel ends its deliberations on the proposed budget for the office of the president without raising any questions.
The Philippine peso falls to its lowest level versus the U.S. dollar at 56.77.
And the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention approves the use of Omicron-specific booster shots.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crew.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Story. Areas in the northern Philippines again in the path of a storm. Strong winds along with moderate to at times intense rains are being experienced in some provinces due to Typhoon Henry. Classes and government work in several areas were also suspended. Based on the State Weather Bureau's forecast track, Henry is expected to exit the Philippine area of responsibility on Saturday evening or Sunday morning.
The Social Welfare Department activates its quick response teams due to Typhoon Henry. The agency says relief goods and standby funds worth more than 1.5 billion pesos are readily available for its disaster response operations. DSWD Chief Erwin Tulfo has also directed the regional directors to be proactive in pre-positioning resources. The DSWD urges the public to remain vigilant and cooperative. The Philippine Disaster Management Agency also on alert for Typhoon Henry. The National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council says areas in the path of the storm have been reminded to make the necessary preparations.
Since August 31, ay tuloy-tuloy yung ating bigay ng mga abiso sa mga LGUs. And so far, maganda naman ang mga reports na natatanggap natin. Lahat po ay nakahanda, lahat po ay nag-anticipate dito sa epekto ng bagyo. As far as major infrastructures, wala po tayong nakikitang major damage dito kasi medyo malayo siya. So kasi ang threat lang talaga dito ay yung malakas na hangin, yung dagat, no, maalon, and of course yung pag-ulan doon sa areas na yan. But tingnan pa rin natin yung epekto ng habagat na pwedeng dalhin nitong Henry, lalo na sa Regions 1 and CAR. So yun po, babantayan natin yan.
One of the Philippine provinces directly affected by Typhoon Henry is Batanes. Governor Marilu Kaiko now joins us to give us an update on the latest situation in the province. Good afternoon, Governor.
Good afternoon sa lahat, Ron, at sa lahat ng inyong mga pakinig.
Governor, we do know that Batanes is under signal number 2, and while we're looking at weather maps, it shows strong winds there. What's the situation in the province right now?
Mayos naman po ang aming kalagayan dito sa Batanes. Bagamat pabugso-bugso na ang ulan, medyo malakas ang hangin kumpara kahapon. Lumakas din ang ulan kaninang umaga. At ngayong hapon ay hindi na siya masyadong nalakas. Pero nalakas pa rin yung hangin gawa yung habagat. Number 2 na po kami dito, pero okay pa ang kalagayan namin dito. Ang stationary lang yung bagyo, Typhoon Henry. Gayun pa man, hindi kami nag-ambante dahil wala pa rin katiyakan itong bagyo hanggang tumuyan itong palabas ng ating bar. Normally, kasi minsan, yung bagyo ay ang direksyon. Kaya pwede bumalik dito sa amin or dinag-direksyong nabayo sa atin. So, ngayon umaga, o kahapon, kagabi pa lang, nag-suspend ako ng klase dahil sa hangin at ulan. ngayong madaling araw, nagsimulan man ako ng work sa government offices, maliban lang sa mga opisina na may kaugnayan sa disaster response, health services at iba pang essential services.
Governor,
sa panahon ng kalamidad.
Ang alam nga po namin is you've been preparing for the storm. Local government, pati po yung mga nakatira dyan, naghahanda na po kay Henry nung Tuesday pa lang po, at least nung Tuesday pa lang po.
Bito kami nung Tuesday. Yeah. Opo.
Mm-hmm. Anong preparasyon po ang mga ginawa nun? Yung lalo na po sa pag-preposition ng mga goods tsaka mga equipment?
Una po ay tinatawag ko yung aking Provincial Disaster Relief Management Officer at lahat ng mga municipal disaster risk reduction management officers para simulan na agad-agad ang paghahanda at siguraduhin na lahat ng mga barangay ay may sapat na kaalaman at kahandaan.
Mm-hmm.
Ang una po namin ginawa ay may information dissemination sa pamamagitan ng Bandilio at maging sa aming Facebook page. Sinabi namin na magsimula ng itali ang kanilang mga bahay-bahay, lalo na ang mga gawa sa light materials at maglagay na ng mga window shutters.
Mm-hmm.
At pinayuhang kunin ang maglinis sila sa kanilang kapatigiran at siguraduhin na walang mabagay ang maaaring magdulot ng kapahamakan sa kanila. Tapos po, lahat po ng mangingisda at boat owners ay pinayuhan ng huwag ng pumalaot at itali na rin sa ligtas na lugar ang kanilang mga bangka.
Mm-hmm.
Natutuwa naman ako pag ipot ko kahapon at ngayong umaga ay nakita kong secured yung mga bangka at tinalian nila. Tapos po, yung mga bahay-bahay, lalo na yung light materials, nakatali din at tumulong yung Batanes sa tour guide sa mga bahay-bahay, mga may-ari ng light materials para ho i-secure yung kanilang bahay at nagbigay ho kami sa nagbigay ang provincial government ng nylon ropes sa barangay para doon sila kumuha ng tantali nila ng bahay nila.
Mm-hmm.
At yung paglagay ng window shutters ay ganun din, tulungan din. Dito naman sa Batanes kasi, uso dito yung bayanihan pag ganun po. Tapos po, lahat ng mga opisina ng pamahalan ay sinulatan ko upang maghanda. Sumulat din ako sa lahat ng mga mayors at barangay captain upang siguraduhin na lahat ng kanilang nasasakupan ay magiging handa.
Governor, pinapakita po namin ngayon yung mga ibang litrato dyan sa Batanes, no, na tama nga po, tinatalian na yung mga bubong, pati po yung mga barko, tapos nilagyan na po ng shutter yung mga bintana. Nakakatuwa naman po tignan. Yung mga residente po, sabi nyo medyo lumalakas yung hangin, pabugso-bugso, yung ulan, bumubugso din. Pero hindi naman po nangyayari na tuloy-tuloy na malakas yung hangin at ulan.
Hindi po. Mm-hmm. Hindi lang namin alam. Kaya nga kahit na walang pasok, pumasok po kami. Kasi na 24/7 nakasabay po kami. Kasi experience dito sa Batanes. Alam niyo naman po, Typhoon Belt itong Batanes.
Mm-hmm.
So experience po namin ay pwede hong mag-change yung direction ng wind. Pag nag-change yung direction ng wind, pwede hong bumalik. Pwede hong lumapit sa amin. Pag ganun kalakas yung bagyo ay kahit gilid lang noon mararamdaman ho namin.
Itong si Henry nga medyo bumabagal nga, no, bago siya magparang U-turn pataas.
Humina din po.
Humina, buti nga po humina, pero siyempre meron pa rin pong bantaja sa Batanes. Yung mga residente po doon sa pabugso-bugsong hangin at ulan, wala naman pong naapektuhan o nasaktan pa?
Wala po. Sa awan ng Diyos, wala po. At umikot po ako kanina para tingnan kung may mga landslide o kaya yung mayroon mga nasiraan o nadisgrasya. Sa awan ng Diyos, wala naman po. Mayroon lang mga nahulog na bato-bato sa taas. So, lumalag po yun pag ganyan ng panahon.
Wala pong inevacuate ng maaga dyan sa inyo?
mayroon lang kaming in-evacuate kagabi. Mayroon lang in-evacuate isang pamilya, limang membro. Tapos in-evacuate at nilagay, kasi light materials ang kanilang bahay. Nasa bus evacuation sila at inaasikaso sila ng MSWD o ng bus ko po.
Yung ano po, yung mga food packs kung sakasakali para doon sa mga residente na aside from that family po na isang pamilya na nag-evacuate na at kung dumami pa, meron naman po nakahandang food packs yan.
Mayroon po kami, lumuwas ako sa Manila, ay pumunta po ako personally kay Secretary Tulfo. Humingi po ako ng pang-preposition namin na family food packs at binigyan po kami ng 5,000. At ito na-distribute na namin sa limang munisipyo, anima munisipyo namin. Isa lang yung hindi pa namin dahil matawana ang dagat nung gawin namin at nasaya. Kaya yan yung Punta Island at pagdahan. 85 island na pagdahan ng dahon namin. So, 5,000 na yan, enough na po yan sa amin. At mayroon din po kami sa input pass dito sa provincial government na kung sakasakali po ay kukulangin, ay mayroon po kami na ibibigay. Tapos po, nakaano na po yan, preposition sa mga munisipyo. Tapos namili din po kami ng housing materials gaya ng Hero, 3,400 lumber, 3,400 GI pipe. Ito ang hagi namin kung mayroon matisilaan po ng bahay. Ito lahat nandun sa aming logistic hub po.
Meron po din po kaming na balitaan kanina na nawawalan po ng kuryente na rin po dyan sa Batanes. Totoo po ba yan?
Hindi. Dapat nakakita po kasi magkaroon ng brownout starting tonight. From 2 to 5 at na-approve po yung fuel for Batanes. Pero last week pa namin yan pinag-uusapan ng manager ng Napocor dito at dahil sabi niya wala nang delivery yung Petron sa Napocor. Pero napagbigyan po kami na mula sa ang supply namin from September to December ay i-deliver po pag maganda ho ang panahon. Kaya po, wala na ho kami brownout sa gabi.
That's good to know. Governor Marilu Caico, thank you very much for giving us updates in Batanes. Sana ho, gumanda na ho yung panahon dyan.
Opo, maraming salamat, Rohan, at mabuhay po kayo.
Thank you very much. Governor Marilu Caico of Batanes giving us an update on the situation in Batanes. They're experiencing intermittent strong winds and rains. There was one family that was preemptively evacuated. They were living in a house made of weak materials and they have been evacuated early. The governor also giving us an update about the residents there already shuttering windows, also securing their houses as well as their boats. About 5,000 food packs have already been distributed.
More news. A landslide in Ifugao leaves at least one person dead. The landslide happened Thursday following heavy rains caused by Typhoon Henry. Authorities say the 37-year-old man was staying at the house of his brother when the incident happened.
The mayor of Masantol in Pampanga seeking the help of the national government to deal with severe flooding. 22 out of 26 villages there remain flooded. 19 out of the town's 28 schools also inundated.
We're appealing to the national government to put us under the magnifying glass and silipin po ang bayan ng Masantol and to consider us as one of the towns in our in the country na talagang nangangailangan po ng national government agents na intervention. And we've asked them, we've appealed to them na kung pwede, huwag po nating i-risk ang ating mga educators, huwag po nating i-risk ang ating mga mag-aaral. Kung pwede, let's shift back to blended learning. Huwag po nating pilitin yung face-to-face kung talagang hindi kailangan at kung talagang nasa peligro po ang ating mga mag-aaral at mga educators.
The proposed budget of the Office of the Philippine President hurdles a House panel without any deliberation. House Majority Leader Manuel Dalipe moved to terminate the budget briefing, citing supposed tradition of extending parliamentary courtesy to a co-equal branch in government. House Appropriations Committee Chair Zaldi Co approved the motion after it was seconded by other lawmakers. Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez attended the hearing and thanked the committee.
You can be assured that the Office of the President is here together with you, Your Honors, in meeting the expectation and hopes of the more than 112 million Filipinos which the President now leads in promoting the people's welfare and upholding the interests of the nation.
Nicolas Cari. President Marcos's office has asked for a budget of 8.9 billion pesos for next year. Congressman Raul Manuel, a member of the chamber's Progressive Makabayan Bloc, vowed to scrutinize the budget during the plenary deliberations.
We just like to manifest that we will raise our points in the plenary session concerning confidential and intelligence funds and the fund for the oversight on national security programs under the Office of the President.
Mr. Aldi. House Deputy Minority Leader and ACT Teachers Party List Representative Franz Castro, meanwhile, hits what she calls the blind approval of the budget of the Office of the President. She says the committee blatantly violated basic principles of transparency and accountability. She asserts the president's budget must be scrutinized and the massive confidential and intelligence funds be explained. The proposed budget for the Environment Department next year faces the House lawmakers' scrutiny. Let's get an update from ABS-CBN correspondent Vivian Guria. Viv?
Hi, Denise. The Department of Environment and Natural Resources is looking very closely into the environment and social impact of the Manila Bay Dolomite Beach project, according to the agency's new chief, Secretary Maria Antonia Yulo Loizaga. That says environmental groups, scientists, and communities raised concerns on its implementation. Yulo Loizaga said there will be public consultation on the matter. She issued this statement during the House Committee on Appropriations deliberation of the agency's proposed 23 billion peso budget for 2023 in response to ACT Teachers Party List Representative Franz Castro's question over the possible effects of the Dolomite project on flooding in Manila. According to the DENR, the placement of Dolomite sand over the 500-meter stretch from the U.S. Embassy to Remedios has been completed. DENR USEC Jonas Leones, meanwhile, told the committee that water hyacinths and solid waste continue to be the major problem in efforts to rehabilitate Manila Bay. The agency plans to coordinate with the Department of Human Settlements and Urban Development to prioritize the relocation of informal settlers living along river systems connected to Manila Bay. Also during the committee's budget deliberations, Gabriela Party List Representative Arlene Brosas flagged the 13.4 billion peso lump sum fund for climate change expenditures in the DENR's proposed 2023 budget, warning that it is vulnerable to misuse. Brosas proposed to reallocate the said funds for subsidies to sectors directly affected by climate change through agencies implementing actual climate adaptation programs. Yulo Loizaga said the agency defers to the Department of Budget and Management in terms of the policy directions on the use of the lump sum fund for climate change expenditures. But she noted that the agency involved in climate change adaptation, mitigation, and disaster risk reduction programs intend to converge their resources to address the national and local level impacts of climate change. Here is a portion of that soundbite.
$4.32 billion for allocation to local government units and yung ano eh no tsaka $9.08 billion for budgetary support to government corporations. Actually, these are lump sum appropriations. Mr. Chair, hindi ba vulnerable ito to fund misuse and sa climate change expenditure na kalagay na sa forma ng SPF? Di ba climate pork ito? Napakadali pong ipakete ang isang programa para sa kalikasan pero posibleng pork barrel pala at pinagmumula ng korupsyon.
We all know that risk and vulnerability are local. However, there is a need for an integrated system of policy as well as national to local coherence in the implementation of that policy regarding climate change adaptation, mitigation, and disaster risk reduction. In the cabinet cluster for climate change adaptation, mitigation, disaster risk reduction, there is a specific intent to converge the different resources that are available in each national government agency in order to address both national and local level impacts of climate change.
Brosas told the DENR that there should still be parameters guiding the use of convergence funds. The DENR is also looking into the possibility of including climate education and disaster risk reduction to the basic education curriculum. Denise, back to you.
Thanks, Viv. Now, a fact-checking initiative to be launched by the Philippine Press Secretary's Office. Secretary Trixie Cruz Angeles bared that Friday during the hearing into her office's proposed budget for next year. But she admits funding remains a challenge for this initiative.
Mayroon po kaming plano na mag-create ng fact-checking team at saka pagbibigay ng additional na impormasyon ukol dun sa mga raging issues. Nagmo-monitor po kami ng social media at nagiging responsive po kami. Hindi pa po ganung kalaganap siguro dun sa punto na lahat ng mga instances of potential fake news ay masasagot namin. Gayunpaman, inuumpisahan namin na mas responsive kami dun sa mga issues.
Meanwhile, government-sequestered broadcast firm IBC 13 will shut down by January 2023 unless it is funded. That's according to Press Secretary Trixie Cruz Angeles as she appealed to lawmakers to adjust IBC 13's budget. Angeles notes IBC was given zero budget because its category was for privatization. But according to law, if IBC will be privatized, it needs to deliver at least 1 billion pesos for the modernization of another government-run station or government-run station, PTV. Angeles explains, at its current state, IBC cannot raise that amount.
Sa IBC po, ito po makikita na natin na humingi po kami sa Personal Services, MOOE at Capital Outlay para maituloy natin ang pag-broadcast ng IBC pero nasiro na po sila completely. Meron kaming konting apila. Kung hindi po malagyan ang IBC, mawawalan po ng trabaho yung ating workers at by January, close operations na po tayo.
The Office of the Press Secretary and attached agencies' combined budget for 2023 is 24% lower than the previous year's budget worth 1.6 billion pesos. Angeles says PTV's funds were also cut, which would prevent them from raising salaries. She explains PTV is designated to handle news and information, while IBC is tasked to handle education, culture, and the arts. President Marcos will bring up key developments in Asia during his state visits to Indonesia and Singapore. The Foreign Affairs Department says topics will include the issue in the West Philippine Sea.
Aside from discussing bilateral relations, there will be an exchange of views on regional and global developments. And as all are actually leaders and members of ASEAN, there will clearly be discussions on key regional issues of mutual interest, including the West Philippine Sea or South China sea issue, cognizant that all three countries are actually have the common goal to maintain peace and stability and prevent incidents in this particular part of the world.
The Foreign Affairs Department adds Marcos will witness the signing of key agreements on defense and culture in Indonesia. While in Singapore, he will see the signing of agreements on counterterrorism and data privacy. Marcos kicks off his inaugural state visits on September 4, Sunday.
Senator Robin Padilla dismayed over the absence of some cabinet secretaries in a hearing into proposals to change the 1987 Constitution. Out of four cabinet members invited, only National Security Advisor Clarita Carlos showed up. Socioeconomic Planning Chief Arsenio Balisacan and Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno sent representatives who attended virtually, while Energy Secretary Rafael Otilia sent his regrets. This prompted Padilla, who chairs the Senate Committee on Constitutional Amendments, to make his case for a parliamentary form of government.
Ang akala ko, kaalyado natin itong mga nasa executive. Kung kaalyado namin talaga kayo, eh siputin nyo kami. Napakahirap po ng sitwasyon natin. Gusto natin bumalanse, pero kung ganyan naman ang maaabutan namin dito, magparlamentary na ho tayo. Wala na ho akong pag-uusapan dito, kundi magparlamentary na tayo. Para harap-harapan tayo. Ang hirap ng ganito, tagoon eh.
The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention approves the use of Omicron-specific booster shots. The green light for the jabs of Moderna and rival Pfizer-BioNTech will enable millions of the redesigned shots to be rolled out by next week. The Food and Drug Administration has said the shots that target the dominant BA4 and BA5 subvariants will help patients avoid long COVID. Moderna's booster has been approved for use on individuals aged 18 and above, while Pfizer-BioNTech can be given to people aged 12 and older. Back here at home, more health experts oppose moves to ease the face mask mandate. Dr. Benito Atienza, former Philippine Medical Association president, says local officials should abide by policies implemented by the national government. He also asserts the threat of COVID remains.
Tayo nasa ano pa rin nasa national emergency ano pa rin situation, at sinasabi nga natin yung isa ang mask ay isang protection laban sa pagkakahawa natin sa COVID-19. Hindi lang po sa COVID-19, sa panahon nyo po ngayon, ang dami may upo, may sipon at saka may pneumonia. Ito po isang pananggalang po para natin para sa ating isang mga sakit na umaano po ngayon, nag-i-increase.
Cebu City has pushed through with its implementation of the eased face mask policy. Interior Chief Benner Abalos has said he will talk to Cebu City Mayor Michael Rama to reconsider his decision.
In other news, the number of regions in the Philippines exceeding their dengue epidemic threshold is declining. The health department says only 6 regions to date are beyond that level. It adds Metro Manila remains among regions with the highest dengue cases in the country.
Currently, we only have 6 out of the 17 regions exceeding the thresholds for epidemic. These are regions 2, 3, 4A, 4B, CAR, and NCR. In these past 4 weeks, based on this reporting that we are doing. Ngayon po, recent time period, meron tayong 19,816 cases, kung saan ang pinakamataas na numero sa mga regions are Regions 3, NCR, and Region 2.
Up next, the Philippines and the U.S. hold a 2-day maritime drill.
And an opposition senator insists someone in Malacanang must be held accountable over a botched sugar importation plan. More news when we return.
Back with more news. The Philippine Coast Guard insists its two-day maritime drills with the U.S. are not meant to intimidate other countries. The search and rescue exercise will be held on September 2nd and 3rd in the West Philippine Sea near Zambales. The drills involve some 250 U.S. Coast Guard personnel and 150 from the Philippine Coast Guard. The exercise aims to enhance their interoperability of the forces from the two allied nations.
Wala tayong isyong pinag-uusapan dito. Ito'y normal na trabaho ng Philippine Coast Guard. At yan ay gagawin natin kahit sino pa yung ka-exercise natin. Kahit China pa o yung Japan na ginagawa naman natin itong dati.
This is the third joint search and rescue exercise between the two Coast Guards. They conducted the same drills in 2019 and 2020. This year's event comes amid heightened tensions between China and the U.S.
The Philippines should not restart oil and gas talks with China. That's the view of Fisher's group Pamalakaya. The group is convinced nothing good will come out of the deal. It also doubts that China will abide by a proposed 60-40 sharing scheme in favor of the Philippines. Pamalakaya notes Beijing has never abided by an international ruling which invalidated its claim in Manila's territorial waters. It also believes China has deliberately disrespected the rights of Filipino fishermen in the Philippines' traditional fishing grounds. The group urges the Marcos administration to instead push for negotiations that would recognize the country's arbitral win over Beijing.
Government agencies and telco firms take action following the proliferation of text scams containing the full names of recipients. We have more from Jackie Pascual.
Text scams have become personalized, with many complaining of receiving text messages offering work or money, and this time with their names included in the message.
Yung mismo yung pangalan ko, Sir Alex, yun, nanalo ka ng 100,000.
Nagtataka lang po ako bakit nagtetext sila ng ganun. Kasi nga, hindi pa po ba nila naiisip na mahirap na nga po yung mga tao. Nagkaroon na nga po ng pandemya, tapos manggaganon pa sila.
Even Supreme Court Senior Associate Justice Marvick Leonin expresses concern and calls the scam very dangerous. He suspects data may have been leaked or sold. The National Telecommunications Commission is alarmed by the rising number of text scams, especially where personal details are included in the message.
Kanilang style ngayon is mapapanggap na kakilala kasi may pangalan na eh. So kung ikaw naman ay kakilala ko nito, so maniniwala ka ngayon. So click dito, click doon. That's the problem. Kasi scam 'yun.
Cabarrios believes the personal information were collected from social media sites, messaging apps, and even from forms where people usually fill up information. A digital advocacy group also says private companies and government agencies may have been exposed to data breach, resulting in the spread of people's personal information. Senator Bong Revilla is calling on NTC to beef up measures against tech scam, saying a criminal syndicate may be behind it. The NTC admits it would be difficult to identify the perpetrators as it is hard to track text messages. NTC has ordered telcos to issue text warnings to its subscribers, as it also urges telcos to block numbers from scammers.
Wag na wag ka kagat, no? I-block, i-delete yung message, at i-report. Pagka may link na pinapapunta ka, wag na wag gagawin yun.
Cabarrios also supports the proposed SIM card registration bill to help track those who send text scams. Globe says it has blocked 784 million scam and spam messages and has deactivated 14,000 numbers and blacklisted about 9,000 phone numbers. PLDT Smart also says it is also strengthening its cybersecurity efforts to protect subscribers. The public is urged to report text scams to the Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The National Privacy Commission also investigating the proliferation of spam text messages. Privacy Commissioner John Henry Naga says they are coordinating with telco providers as well as the NTC to gather more information. Naga also urged Filipinos to remain vigilant in protecting their personal data. Meanwhile, the Philippine Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center is taking its cues from other countries that are experiencing similar problems.
We are on our toes here, and we are not just hitting it on the side of regulation, because you just keep on regulating, you are pressing on the private sector, on, and then para ka nag-aabang ng mga kaso, and it's not good. This is not only purely local in nature. All the countries are experiencing the same thing. Okay, the same thing. And we're trying to configure how we're going to be doing the cross-border digital data that will be appreciated by other countries so that we can figure out how we're going to go about this.
The Philippine peso hits a new all-time low against the U.S. dollar. The local currency closed at 56.77 against the greenback on Friday. The closing figure beat its previous weakest level of 56.45, which was set on October 2004, or nearly 18 years ago. During intraday trading, the peso also reached a peak of 56.90. For an economist, remittances from overseas Filipino workers will play an important role in strengthening the local currency.
We have the traditional or seasonal influx of dollars from OFWs in the last 2 months of the year. So there may be some easing. I think that we can see could possibly break 56. So I think my range is 55, 50 to 56 end of the year. The BSP doesn't have to match the Fed rate hikes one for one, because the U.S. economy comes from a real yield of negative right now. So while we are slightly positive, so it's a little bit different.
The PSE index ends Friday as the best performer in Asia, but its strong performance is still not enough to notch a weekly gain. Michelle Ong with the details.
Asian markets muted while the U.S. dollar stood tall at a two-decade high on Friday, ahead of the release of a key U.S. jobs report that could bolster the case for a more aggressive Fed that could hit risky assets. While oil also gained ahead of an OPEC Plus meeting, MSCI's Asia ex Japan suffered its worst weekly performance since mid-June. Here at home, Philippine shares rebounded, with a PSE index gaining, although not enough to post a weekly gain. The index now down for a second week. First Metro Securities' Royce Aguilar sees more consolidation ahead and advises investors to continue betting on reopening names in retail, finance, and property.
For the short term, definitely still consolidating, because we can, if you take a look at the price action, it's getting bullish, but it's not yet significantly bullish. There's still resistance levels, and as for fundamentals, it seems like it's getting better, but there's still risk. Being aggressive is not yet recommended.
Trader Miko Sayo also sees more sideways trade.
The best that this market can do is probably just trade sideways for now. The looks of it today, you know, it seems like it's going to break above that 57 level very, very soon. Of course, the coming very aggressive hawkish stance of the Fed in the U.S. will increase the interest rate differentials between our economy and theirs. So that's going to be an issue for the peso dollar, and it will trigger more weakness on the peso.
In corporate stories, Aboitiz Infra Capital is buying one-third of GMR Megawide Cebu Airport Corporation, the developer and operator of the Mactan Cebu International Airport, for 9.5 billion pesos. Post-transaction, Megawide and India's GMR Airports International BV will each have 33 1/3% stakes. Meanwhile, Megaworld and GMR will also issue exchangeable notes for the aggregate amount of 15.5 billion to mature in October 2024 and will be exchanged by Aboitiz Infra Capital for the remaining 66 2/3% of the joint venture. Megawide says the deal will enable it to crystallize its assets' fair market value and unlock resources to accelerate development infrastructure portfolio for its long-term financial management program. In construction, Megawide has bagged several big-ticket items, including the Malolos-Clark Railway Project and the Metro Manila Subway Project. Meanwhile, Andratan Spirits company Empedador, which listed at the Singapore Stock Exchange last July, enters the 30-stock Straits Times Index. This takes effect at the start of trade on September 19. Inclusion in the index will give the stock a wider reach among institutional investors as well as active and passive funds. Empedador owns the world's fifth-largest Scotch whiskey producer, White & Mackay, as well as Fundador Brandy and the Dalmore. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Turning now to the sugar importation mess, Senator Riz Ontivero says the continued absence of Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez in their probe sets a dangerous precedent. Ontivero's fears this may embolden other officials of the executive branch to snub future Senate hearings.
I join my minority leader, Senator Coco, that E.S. Rodriguez must face the committee. Bakit siya bibigyan ng exemption? No? First 100 days pa lang, may excuse letter na kaagad. I mean, anong kinatatakutan niya? What information is he hiding? What information doesn't he want the public to know? I want to find out from him what his take is on the conflicting stories about how the president found out about the draft sugar order number 4. Is it true that the president with the ES only found out about it on the SRA website? Or, as the former SRA officials say, that they personally, Yusek Sebastian in particular, personally informed the president about the sugar order.
Ontivero adds someone in Malacanang must be held accountable.
Buck should stop in Malacanang because the executive secretary was involved at certain points of the process, but unfortunately wouldn't allow the Blue Ribbon to complete the picture. Andito tayo sa gitna ng isang food crisis. Economists warn us not to allow it to degenerate into a food catastrophe. The president has to be better served by his executive secretary or by his cabinet, by the office of the ES getting its act together.
More to come. Myanmar's former leader Aung San Suu Kyi sentenced to 3 more years in jail for electoral fraud. Stay with us. Official secrets. All charges against her carry a combined jail term of 190 years.
The head of the UN's nuclear agency worried over the state of the Zaporizhia nuclear plant in Ukraine. Rafael Grossi says it is clear the physical integrity of the plant has been violated several times. The Zaporizhia plant, Europe's largest nuclear facility, has endured repeated shelling in recent weeks. Grossi says his 14-man team will stay at the facility until Sunday or Monday to continue the assessment. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky, however, is disappointed with the results of the agency's first visit. He says Grossi's group failed to state the key point of the mission, which is the demilitarization of the area.
Finance ministers from the group of 7 major powers will likely finalize a deal to impose a price cap on Russian oil. That statement coming from a G7 European official ahead of the finance ministers' virtual meeting Friday. British Finance Minister Nadeem Zahawi hopes the chiefs could come up with a statement regarding the matter.
The primary reason I am here in the US is we want to get this oil price cap over the line. We have an important meeting tomorrow with the G7 finance ministers, and I am hopeful we'll be able to have a statement that will mean that we can move forward at pace to deliver this oil price cap. There's a lot going for the British economy as we deal with a dictator who is using energy as a tool in this. So, yeah, tough times, but I think we'll get through it and we'll come out the other end much more resilient.
The planned price cap on Russian oil is aimed at further slashing Moscow's revenues as it continues its aggression against Ukraine. This while still ensuring crude is flowing to avoid price spikes. The G7 consists of Britain, Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, and the U.S.
A feel-good movie in theaters and a new romantic comedy to stream. Our resident movie critic Manny the Movie Guy reviews these two new releases.
The undying bond between humans and animals is at the heart of the new drama, Gigi and Nate.
She likes me, she just doesn't know it yet.
Gigi is a capuchin monkey who gives hope to Charlie Rose, Nate Gibson, a young man who suffers a near-fatal illness and is left a quadriplegic. If you think it's too good to be true, it is. This one's based on a true story.
And 1 year ago, my life completely changed.
To me, that was an incredibly interesting new story that I'd never really heard.
Director Nick Hamm assembled a competent group of actors, including Jim Belushi as Nate's dad, Diane Ladd as the grandma, and Marcia Gay Harden as the mom. But none of them can compare to Gigi.
Let's try the peanut butter.
Come on, Gigi.
You were right, Manny. You were right on about Gigi. She's a little actress. She steals the show. She literally one day put her hand under her chin for her close-up, and then she raised the other one like this, and she kind of did that. And I was like, I'm done.
Gigi and Nate is a movie Walt Disney Pictures used to make. A feel-good charmer that will make you laugh and cry. And sometimes, all you need is a little bit of hope. And for that, Gigi and Nate gets 3 out of 4 uplifting kisses. And on Netflix, the romantic comedy Love in the Villa.
The most romantic and tragic love story of all time.
If you like your rom-coms with a travelogue twist, then take a trip to Love in the Villa. Set in Verona, Italy, Kat Graham plays a young American woman who takes a trip to the romantic city after a breakup.
I knew it was something special.
Her love interest here is played by Tom Hopper, a cynical British man who shares the double-booked villa with our heroine.
I laughed out loud many times.
If you like rom-coms, you will fall in love with Love in the Villa. It's predictable, yes, but the journey here is fun and lighthearted.
The soundtrack, the food, the wine, the fashion, the sights, Verona, they're all right here.
Can I say I'm a fan?
And for that, Love in the Villa gets 3 out of 4 move-in to this villa kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
I was destined for a life of romance.
Destiny is a fantasy.
Before we go, an update on Typhoon Henry. State Weather Bureau Pagasa says Henry continues to weaken. Its maximum sustained winds now at 155 kilometers per hour with gusts of up to 190 kilometers per hour. Storm signal number 2 is still raised over Batanes, which means it may continue to experience moderate to heavy rains and strong winds. Babuyan Islands in the northern or the northeastern portion of mainland Cagayan, meanwhile, are still under signal number 1. Henry is forecast to exit the Philippines Saturday evening or Sunday morning.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsay.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.
The key to recovery, because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have